Hey guys, it's Dr. Danu Sugai, board certified dermatologist. Welcome to my channel. Thank you for subscribing. This is a really great video because I will compile some of the most common skin complaints, especially looking at wrinkles, hollowness under the eyes, when do I use Botox, when do I use filler, those types of questions I get in clinic. I'm going to bring it all here in this video and let's talk about them. People say like, oh, that was some bad Botox in that person's face. Oh, that's really bad filler. How do we know they actually had filler? How do we know they actually had Botox? There are certain areas where you do not use Botox, and then there are areas where you do not inject filler. So let's talk about those things. I've talked about Botox versus fillers in the past in a video back in 2020, I think, when I first started, and my background music was way too loud. So sorry guys for that. Aging is a blessing. As we age, we want to strive for healthier skin and not perfection. We don't want to talk badly about the concept of aging. It is a privilege to age, and I want to take control of how I age though. And so I use certain skincare products and may even consider some procedures. Now, not everyone needs to do a procedure, right? There's different levels of comfort and different levels of invasiveness when it comes to procedures. You know, I'm at the age where I'm in my late 30s. I'm not going to be looking into surgically pulling things back, but there are things you could easily do in your 20s to 30s, and we'll talk about that. And when you have a youthful face, we have an upside down triangle where we don't have that jowly look here. We have nice prominent cheekbones, and our jawline and chin can be quite defined. As we get older and wiser, we are going to have that triangle flip upside down, and then things start to fall this way. And so we start having the jowly look here, less definition in our jawline, and our neck will also start to change as well. And you'll have more vertical lines and cords being more prominent in your platysma muscle, as well as horizontal lines, especially us looking down at our phones, and we call those tech lines now. Things progress that way because we start to have bone absorption. Fat pads start to fall downward, and it really isn't just gravity, right? It's actually like the support here in our bony structures start to fall back into our face and get less of a supportive structure holding up our skin, our muscle, our fat, and things start to fall that way. So when we want to work on lifting things in a non-surgical way and you just want to do injectables, fillers may help, right? Depends on the degree of which things are falling. So for filler, I do filler in my office. I love lip filler because as we get older, our ratio between our upper lip, bottom lip starts to change. Ideally, you want your lower lip a bit bigger than your upper lip. I've always had a larger upper lip, and no, I've never needed filler in my upper lip. But as much as possible, you want a nice prominent upper lip, but a slightly bigger lower lip, right? To keep that normal ratio going. Now, as we get older though, our upper lip starts to thin out, and you can see lip filler is nice to help plump up the lips, and they can last about 6 to 12 months, depending on what lip filler you use. You can really thread that along the border between the vermilion lip and the cutaneous lip right there to help accentuate and make it look a little more puckered. And you can also add volume into your lip. So that's one thing you can do. The other thing is, if things start to fall this way and you start complaining about your nasal labial folds becoming more prominent, we don't just focus on filling in that fold, but we also focus on adding more hyaluronic acid filler to the bony structure here. So by putting it here and rebuilding a new cheekbone, things hopefully lift and you have a softening of your nasal labial fold. Now, if you are out there watching this and you're really bothered by nasal labial folds, I see young kids or even babies with nasal labial folds. So don't chase nasal labial folds with filler, because if you keep chasing and filling this in, you'll have a fuller face, and sometimes it can make that chipmunk look, and that does not look good, right? The other nice thing with fillers you could do besides just augmenting the lips is also pulling the corners up and making a little support there, because as we get older, sometimes we have that little scowl frown look at all times because things start to fall. So if we can add a little hyaluronic acid there, have a little lift there, and at rest, you have that little natural upturn of the corners, that makes a huge difference. As we get older though, you will need more filler, more hyaluronic acid syringes to achieve these results. Filler, I do not recommend applying to the forehead. This is a very vascular area. There's no need to put filler here. And if you're worried about the 11s between your eyebrows, people do try to get filler there, playing with fire there, because this is a very dangerous zone. You can hit a blood vessel, cause necrosis, and cause an ulcer that could lead to permanent scarring there. The other thing is, under the eyes, if you have hollowness there, sometimes it's not just skin laxity, but you actually need to fill that area. You need to add hyaluronic acid to that empty space. You could see some results there, but it's very dangerous to have filler there. So always go to a very experienced injector. And the big risk to that is if you hit the vessel there and cause ischemia of your eye, leading to blindness. So just be sure to always think about risks and benefits. A lot of times I talk my patients out of doing something like that. And a lot of times there's skin laxity issues where that's what's causing the under eye issues, whether it's puffiness, dark circles. A lot of times filler could make it worse, because if there's skin laxity and you're putting filler there, you're just gonna fill that puffy eye bag up and it's gonna look more accentuated. So that is also not a good thing, right? So always talk to an experienced practitioner, provider, doctor who can help tell you what's your main issue. A lot of times we can achieve just improvement in the area with a caffeinated eye serum, whether it's L'Oreal Revitalift caffeinated hyaluronic acid serum, which helps plump the skin while also tightening the blood vessels, causing the blue discoloration, and also the caffeine helps with the puffiness under the eyes. The hyaluronic acid seems counterintuitive, like why do you want to depuff but also hydrate? It'll help with like the nice crow's feet that we get when we smile, and you can achieve a little bit of softening there by having hyaluronic acid, a serum, say with that L'Oreal Paris one, or just massaging it over there and pushing out laterally to help with the lymph fluid go out towards the lymphatic drainage this way. If you keep that bottle in the fridge, it could help with depuffing further. And then the Inkey also makes their caffeinated eye cream, so you can find a few products with caffeine in them. Now, going back to the 11s, what do we do about that if we can't do filler? You could always do a hyaluronic acid serum with a moisturizer if it's very subtle and not too deep, the crease. Hyaluronic acids, we've talked about on the channel. Vichy makes a good one. Hyalu B5 by La Roche-Posay. Those are great starts. The Inkey List makes a nice one, as well as the Ordinary, very affordable brand, and then layer with a moisturizer over it. Now, if you want to prevent the muscle movement that's causing that 11 to begin with, I have this piece of paper here. If you keep moving that corrugator, you have a procerus muscle and the corrugator supercilia, if you keep moving those and contracting it with frowning, over time, that movement will cause a crease. And that's the 11s, right? You have that crease there. So to stop that crease from forming or to make it from getting deeper, we put Botox in these areas to stop our muscles from contracting and causing that to deepen. So that's where Botox comes in. That's a nice, safe neurotoxin that a trained doctor needs to inject into the right areas, and don't want to have any complications of things drooping, eyelid ptosis. Those are the things that you can run into if the provider does not know their anatomy. You can use it for the crow's feet on the sides, but if you hit it too low, you can hit the zygomaticus muscle and cause a droopy smile. Those are all temporary complications, thankfully, because Botox only lasts for 3 to 4 months. Sometimes people get relief for longer, but in general, I say 3 to 4 months is what you're looking at. Thankfully, there's no permanent nerve damage with Botox. It's quite painless, just little needle pokes. We use a 30 gauge, very small, tiny, tiny needle that we use to inject these areas. We like to use it in the forehead because filler, I don't like to use for the forehead at all. And that's great for the horizontal frontal lines, crow's feet, the frown 11s here. And then also you can use a little small amount for here for the lip flip. And you can also work on the vertical cords in your neck when you're smiling or making the Hulk expression. Those cords we can also soften by putting some Botox there. And we even put a small amount in the horizontal tech lines if people are really bothered. Botox is also nice if you have a very wide jawline and you have a strong masseter muscle because you're grinding a lot. That masseter muscle hypertrophies. And a lot of my Asian female patients like to get this done, is getting Botox in the masseter to help take away that strong contraction, because this is an incredibly strong muscle. It will just soften that a bit so that you get a little atrophy of the muscle and it helps soften that jawline a bit. That's quite expensive for that procedure. You need to put a lot of units of Botox there. There's the movement that we're working on, dynamic rightids, where you're having wrinkles or rightids from dynamic movement. That's Botox. Static rightids or static wrinkles where you're at rest and you have that little bit of a frown downturn look to your mouth. You want to augment your lips and help with the vertical lines, or that we call it the smoker lines. If you're a smoker, you can have those vertical lines come out at an earlier age. You want to help soften those things. Filler is best for that. Looking at the quality of your skin though, how do we improve the texture, the quality, the collagen? Filler and Botox won't influence that as much. Although Botox, you're looking into more research behind it on helping regulate sebum, helping with acne, and maybe even collagen, but I need to see more evidence on that. Different ways to go at collagen. Number one, research back retinol. A retinol or retinoids or a prescription tretinoin you can use for your face, entire face, pea size amount. I'm going to show you here. This is SkinBetter Science Intensive AlphaRet. Buy this on my store, go to your doctor's office and they carry it. All you need is a large pea size amount. So it's usually like one pump. So there you go. Break this up, dots on the face and connect the dots. Okay. Do that at bedtime. That helps with telling your skin make more collagen. There's studies behind that. It's been around for a while. There's retinol, retinaldehyde, and there's prescription stuff like retinoic acid, tretinoin, I prescribe. This is great. This one has alpha hydroxy acids paired with your retinol. So it helps with exfoliation plus increased collagen. Other retinols we've talked about on the channel, there's CeraVe, Olay, Rock is one of my favorite over-the-counter retinols. And Naturium has come out with a nice retinol serum. If you want a retinaldehyde, Naturium came out with one. I have not tried that one yet, but I've tried the Maelove Moonlight serum, which is really nice. That's a nice retinaldehyde serum. Any one of those, if you can't tolerate the prescription stuff, the over-the-counter retinaldehyde or retinol serums you can consider. Now going on, we've talked about this on the channel, vitamin C serums. Vitamin C serums are very important to put into your regimen if you're in your late 20s to early 30s. That helps brighten the skin, but could help with collagen potentially. If you have hyperpigmentation, go for something like SkinCeuticals Fluorotin CF or the Ferulic CE Ferulic by SkinCeuticals. This is a gold standard, but there are more affordable options of this. Coming up, you have Dermatology's Vitamin C E plus F, where you have vitamin C, vitamin E, and ferulic acid, just like the SkinCeuticals. And then you have Maelove, the Glowmaker, which is also with the 15% ascorbic acid, vitamin E, and ferulic acid like the others. This is the most affordable. It's 30-something bucks. Very nice dupe for those. If you want a derivative vitamin C, say ascorbic acid is too irritating for you, or you worry about the instability of vitamin C, you can consider something like Naturium. This is like 20-something bucks at Target. This one has glutathione and gold to stabilize it. I've been actually liking Vanicream's vitamin C serum. I was actually surprised they came out with one, but this one is a vitamin C derivative. And then also you have, of course, Rock's Revive and Glow. This is an ethylated vitamin C serum, very gentle, and I don't find this oxidizing very readily. So I like these options are great for brightening your skin and maybe collagen, but we need to see more studies behind these derivatives if they do help with collagen. Supposedly they do because they're more stable and could penetrate the dermis more readily. Another way to help with collagen would be peptides. Topical peptides are cell signaling. They give the instructions to your cells to make more collagen. I want to mention the Inkey makes a nice peptide moisturizer. In the morning, you cleanse your face, you put your hyaluronic acid serum, and you want to put a moisturizer before your sunscreen, use a peptide moisturizer, or say you put on your retinol at night. Always follow up with a moisturizer. That's non-negotiable. Always put a moisturizer over your retinol. Use a peptide moisturizer for that collagen boost. Other one you can consider with peptides would be Cetaphil serum with peptides. This is a really cool bottle here. I'm going to show you. Look at that. Look at those beads there. So peptides, I'm definitely going to incorporate at my age, in my late 30s. So a moisturizer with peptides or sunscreen with peptides. So I have one skin here. This is a newer brand that I was introduced to very recently. They make nice zinc-based sunscreens that are so lightweight. They blend in very well. They can be water resistant at times, especially their body sunscreen is water resistant. Their facial sunscreen, this is a tinted one that does not have water resistance to it, but it does have peptides in all of them. It's the OS1 peptide. It helps with clearing out senescent cells, cells that have just been burnt out. They're too old to regenerate new collagen. They clear them out and help your skin function more like younger skin. Younger skin does not have so much of those burnt out non-regenerative cells. And so this peptide helps with collagen production, helps with cellular repair. And so I like to have peptides included in my nice skincare products like sunscreen, which is already the goat of anti-aging because you protecting yourself from UV is so important on a daily basis. I can't stress that enough, right, on the channel. Having UV out there, that will chew up our collagen just like smoking would. And smoking actually does it the same, but much faster pace, and it actually is permanent, right? Like once you smoke those cigarettes, what it does to your skin, you can't reverse that damage, right? So getting peptides in your skincare is huge. You don't want to neglect your neck, your chest, the back of your hands. Consider a retinol body lotion to use at bedtime. This is a nice moisturizer. But if you want to prevent crepiness, you want to prevent hyperpigmentation or treat hyperpigmentation, Verst makes a nice one and Naturium makes a nice retinol body lotion. So these are some nice strategies to help with the texture, the actual integrity of the skin, and not just relying on your injectables to do the work. Because I believe that you need skincare, and then once you have that strong foundation, you can start adding in nice things like Botox, filler. If you want to look into devices and lasers and resurface your skin, I do chemical peels to help resurface the skin, help clean out the pores with really strong exfoliants. I'm not a big fan of using niacinamide serums because niacinamide, to be honest, is great as a backup dancer. It's a great supporting actor, but never the main star. So doing niacinamide itself, not a big deal in my book. My playbook does not include exfoliating regularly. I think using harsh exfoliants, if anything, causes more irritation in my patients, especially my patients with rosacea or sensitive skin. So not a big fan of that. Not a big fan of those scrubs, the exfoliating brushes. If we were meant to do that, our fingertips would be made of bristles. Doing chemical exfoliants every once in a while is fine, but not every day. Maybe 1 to 2 times a week is all you need. Or if you want to have an exfoliant mixed into your product, like the AlphaRet by SkinBetter Science, that's probably more preferable than scrubbing the dead skin cells away. So I hope this video was helpful, just kind of talking about some common complaints, whether it's skin brightening, collagen production, static versus dynamic wrinkles. Hope this video was helpful in like clearing those things up, okay? So please hit the like button. Thank you for subscribing to the channel, and please hit that bell notification. We'll see you guys every Saturday morning for these long form videos. Take care and peace.